This is a message for all the people of Earth. This is a message from the future of the Earth, transmitted to its past. The moment has come for all people to embrace new ideas to solve the most complex problem of all, the long-term survival of complex life on the planet. This is a call for the people of Earth to become interplanetary. It is a plea for reflection. It is a call to action, a request for reason. It is time to accept the need to work towards the creation of a prosperous Earth and to bring the light of reason to the far reaches of the galaxy. This is a message for all people of Earth and the descendants of Earthlings. It is time to change the world, one planet at a time. Let's face it, there's something crazy and a bit epic about a project whose tagline is changing the world one planet at a time. The whole idea of interplanetary grows out of complexity science. To be successful in a project like this, you need very special people to ask crazy, ambitious questions, to be radical, maverick, and revolutionary. You know, one of the most important photographs that we have is a photograph of the Earth from space, because what that photograph showed us was this one living planet in an otherwise lifeless universe. And the fact is, this planet won't last forever, but we would like the best of what we have created to last beyond our own planet. And to do this, we need to combine so much of what humans have created in their histories: cities, civilizations, great works of art, great works of music, scientific theories, incredible artifacts of engineering. We have to bring them all together. You have to set yourself an almost impossible creative task. What would it take to become an interplanetary civilization? And everyone knows that when extraterrestrials visit the planet Earth, they crash in New Mexico. So why is interplanetary important now? One is, we're going through a new space race. There's huge interest on setting up a colony on the moon, building a colony on Mars. There are clearly issues of sustainable living and living with a purpose, and it's about the meaning of existence. We need new kinds of ideas. We have to find a new language. We need to find ways of allowing creative minds, irrespective of privilege and economic circumstance, to contribute to this project. We have the technology to do it. We haven't had the cause. And that's something that's motivating to everybody. A festival like this, or a project like this, can seem like a scientific question, which it is. But beneath the science, beneath the engineering, beneath the technology, is one of the deepest questions of all. And that is, what is the ultimate objective of life in the universe? What we're trying to do now is solve a really hard cultural problem. We love worlds that don't really exist. We, in fact, like worlds that don't really exist more than the world that exists. We now turn to art, to film, or games, to explore alternative ways of being. But what we want to do is take some of those worlds that don't exist and use them to improve the world that does exist. And interplanetary takes our fascination with space, science fiction, rocketry, and it combines it with new ideas in science, with a sense of urgency that we have to change the way people think about complex systems. Inject what we find in science fiction, in literature, in music, back into rigorous ideas. The life individuals lead now have consequences over the entire planet. And so the interplanetary perspective forces everybody to address the global implications of their local behaviors. It's time to come together to solve a huge problem. The problem is the problem of the long-term sustainability of our planet and taking the best of what we've done beyond the confines of our atmosphere to the rest of the universe. This is urgent. If we don't do this now, we're f***ed beyond belief. Right, so just very quickly, you can sort of see this is a sort of crazy, ambitious thing that we're embarking on. Just a few points. I sort of start these proceedings typically by thanking a few people, and this tonight will be no exception. So Thornburg Investment Management support these public events. Lensic, the best theater in the universe. Last time they were the best in the world. But for this project, it seems fitting to thank them. Of course, I'm going to get to our folks in a second. I want to mention our partner in reaching out to the community here, and that's Creative Santa Fe. I don't know where you're sitting, but they're somewhere in the audience. Help us connect to a lot of the extraordinary talent in this town, city, and of course many other partners that you'll see appearing over the course of the next several years. There is one person I really want to specially call out, because the reason why this project exists and the reason why these people are here is because one visionary investor believes in the whole concept of interplanetary. And when you meet someone like that in your life, you sort of thank somebody for that. Great honor to be able to actually fulfill your vision, because most people would turn around and call you crazy. And that person is not the Santa Fe Bill Miller, but the Santa Fe Institute Miller, the former chair of our board. And join me in thanking him for making this possible. Okay. So with that out of the way, I did a very brief intros to these people you have on your boarding passes. I hope you read the fine print on your card, because I won't name the airline that we excerpted that information from. But just in around, as you move around this circle, at the end there we have Dario Robleto. Dario is an artist. He's an artist in residence at SETI, and is interested in how we would communicate aesthetically beyond the boundaries of our planet. This is Kate Greene. Kate Greene is a science writer and writer, and has spent time, locked up simulating a potential Mars mission. This is Scott Ross. Scott is a pioneer in graphics and digital filmmaking, and many of us, I think, grew up learning about this world through the films that he's worked on. Over here, Sandy Faber. Sandy is a great cosmologist, responsible for building extraordinary telescopes that have made that world available to us. Neil Stevenson, novelist extraordinaire, polymath, who puts wonderful ideas into humanized realities. And last but not least, our very own Santa Fe Institute professor, Jeffrey West, author of the phenomenal book Scale. You should all go out and buy it, and a great thinker on the future of our planet. So without further ado, I want to ask a question that Dario actually recommended that I ask all of the panelists. And it's a very difficult question, and it has two parts. And the first part, and it bears on a remark that I made in the reporter, and that is that if we had to communicate to a tribunal, to an extraterrestrial tribunal of infinite wisdom and judgment, what the human beings or the human species have done that we can be most proud of, what would that be? And so I'm going to start at that end. Oh. Jeffrey has a good answer to this. With Jeffrey, what would you answer when they asked you?
I have to give more than one example. The first, I guess, it would be something that connotes, because I'm a physicist, would connote the extraordinary achievements that we've done in understanding the universe around us. So it would be something like Maxwell's equations of electricity and magnetism, or quantum mechanics, but something of that nature. The second would be something that I think might have some universality, and that is music. And so I would choose possibly a Beethoven quartet, a late Beethoven quartet. And finally, this one I'm slightly hesitant. One of the things that that appears to be true, as far as we know, we're the only part of the universe that sort of cares. We brought morals and ethics to at least this planet. Maybe they exist elsewhere. And it's very hard to communicate that. So my image is of showing sex, two people loving each other, physically, caressing, very gentle, very passionate, but very gentle sensitivity. And I think that's a very important aspect of being human, as distinct from just being an animal procreating through sex.
When Jeffrey told us upstairs, it was much more vivid.
Yes.
Neil.
I'd show them a great old city, such as London or Tokyo, Istanbul, one that's been around for a while and has many layers of civilization and complexity around it. And it's partly because I like old cities. It's partly because cities seem to last longer than just about any other thing that humans create. So it's kind of remarkable in that sense. And I also just think that, being a little tactical for a moment, looking at this hypothetical tribunal, we don't know what their state of mind is, right? We don't know, they may not be impressed by sex, or they may not get the music or some of the other things that we find really interesting and beautiful from our culture. But looking at a city, there'd be no way for them to sort of ignore the fact or fail to see the fact that this thing is incredibly complicated and was the result of many complex interactions taking place over a long span of time. And so I would hope that fact in and of itself would sort of give them a few moments pause before nuking us out of existence or whatever the penalty was for not measuring up.
We had a great conversation about this in the green room before we came down here. And I must say, this question really took me aback. I didn't have an immediate answer for it. But after talking with a couple of other folks, I decided that the key element that I would want them to know about us has something to do with spirituality. It could be religion for many people, but even people who aren't religious have a sense of wonder, a sense of connection to the universe as a whole. And at the same time, I really resonate with what Neil said. The other hallmark of the way we operate is our remarkable degree of cooperation. So having put all this together, I've settled on wanting to show the aliens a telescope. Because
you build them.
Because I could talk a long time about them. That's very true. Because it signifies our interest in a world beyond our own, our curiosity, our longing, deep longing to be closer to the universe, and their complicated machines. They embody all the laws of physics that Jeffrey mentioned. We don't have to write down Maxwell's equations. You have to know those in order to build the telescope. So I've settled on a telescope as the quintessential object, which sums it all up for me.
All right. Now, it turns out that Scott, now, be careful with Sandy with the answer.
No,
okay,
so. So I think the thing that makes us most human is the capacity to love. And that love is really the most powerful thing on the universe. And as a result, what shows love better than art? And so from my perspective, it would be a piece of music and a film. The piece of music would be John Coltrane's A Love Supreme, and the film would be Cinema Paradiso.
So I should reveal a little backstage aggression. When Scott mentioned this, Sandy just wasn't happy and told us...
She actually said she hated John Coltrane.
She hated John Coltrane. It turns out she hates the saxophone. So there's some tension up here.
Mutual respect.
Yeah. Kate, handsome.
I do love all these responses, and you've not left me with much, but at the risk of sounding a little too on message as a writer, I would have to say language. And so that taps into what some of my fellow panelists have already said, but language in so many forms. So that could be pictographic, it could be, lexicographical. I made that word up, and it could be music. So I think language has the ability to show that we communicate with each other and we value connection with each other. And it's a really interesting tool because it can also divide us. But I think we'd like to hope that language has more of a connecting power than that.
To build off a few other points as well, this may sound morbid, but allow me to explain. Because I need to answer it by tying it into where I, in my life as an artist, where I look for the origins of art. Math is a great option to send. I also think case for art can be made, as others are stressing. But the idea that the first time a human decided to stop and bury another, that they took the time to dig a hole and for whatever reason, leaving the body behind no longer made conceptual sense. Perhaps that was driven by emotions, the beginning of a more complex symbology, that the act of burial, for me, was a turning point in this altruism discussion, that we started making decisions that didn't only have a biological need. And we had, again, a wonderful conversation backstage about, can this truly selfless form of altruism exist? Can we have claimed one day that we have evolved in a way that we can give and truly not expect anything back? And I think that's maybe what we hold a type of love up to be, that it is because of the love, that's it, period. No other reason. I don't know that that would, you know, whatever love looks like or emotions or symbolic acts of how we relate to each other, if we were to ever to find that in another species, I would be very curious to know if we could start the conversation there by saying, oh yeah, we also feel responsible to each other through these types of acts. And it's a type of selflessness that was not obvious in the evolution of altruism. But David, I know you could weigh in on this if I've got something way off, but if a truly selfless type of altruism, if we've already got there, or if there's some indication we're on our way there as a thing to communicate.
It's interesting, this sort of science art element here came up, and there's this quote that I like from the Polish writer Lem, Stanislaw Lem, where he says, science can explain the world, but we need art to reconcile us to it. So it sort of can't have one without the other. The second part of that question was turning it around and asking them, what question would you ask them about their accomplishments? And so we also had a debate about that. And I don't know if people want to volunteer in any particular order. What would be the first thing you would ask them that would give you a sense that they'd reached a stage in their evolution where they might be proud of it? Someone had a question.
Well, to build off my last response, I would be curious if the need for an aesthetic response to the questions they asked appeared, meaning art, but any, who knows what form that could take, but that a language needed to be invented to encompass the emotional aspect of looking out into the cosmos. I'd be curious if they, whatever developed from that. It's hard to say it's art, because of course we've constructed that notion as humans. But something that fulfills that need that the science doesn't always fulfill, that they also needed another skill set to describe what they saw.
I just can't get past a very literal-minded answer, which is that by the time we were in a position to ask them that question, we would already know a hell of a lot. So we know that no such civilization exists anywhere near us, so we would already know that they had come from another star system and they had some way of traveling, of building starships. We would apparently be communicating with them in a verbal language of some kind. And we would know that they had the kind of mentality that included setting up tribunals to judge other civilizations, which, you know, says quite a bit right off the bat. You know, that a civilization would think of itself that way. So I'm sort of stuck on all of that preliminary knowledge that we would have. And I think by the time we got to the point of being allowed to pose such questions, we'd be deep into a very sort of strategic, tactical way of thinking about it, like how can we avoid making these people angry?
I'd want to know if they have open carry laws.
Yeah.
I'd actually just like them to share their data.
Their what?
Share their data.
Their data.
All the data that helped them get as far as they did to talk to us.
Right. So with that, Jeffrey, yes.
Well, I have a very sort of naive, sophomoric question I would ask them. And that would be something like, you know, do you ascribe any meaning to your existence?
And you do things. Why do you do them?
I was going to ask them about how they elect their presidents. But that's not, you see, that was very neutral. That was very neutral. So one of the things I think that this whole project raises, the interplanetary thing, is, people have asked, is that appropriate? Is that responsible behavior? There's so much for us to worry about here. There are so many problems we have on this planet. What is this hubris? And some of us believe, and I want to raise this, that sometimes asking very, very ambitious questions, almost sort of unachievable, and you know that, allows you to address real problems, pressing problems, that otherwise you'd be stuck. You wouldn't know how to go about addressing them. And I want that to be very clear this evening, that that's part of what we're doing here. And I do want to ask, because many people have commented on this, that during the World Fair and during the Apollo program and the era of Sputnik, there was a sense of extraordinary excitement around ideas, and that we'd all be, flying around in hover packs, but it never arrived, that future. And just what is the importance of being very ambitious in making progress in science, in art, and society? Just whoever wants to jump in on that one.
I think it's critical. It's critical to, the concept of a moonshot, the concept of setting your goals so high. If you don't challenge yourself to be able to literally reach for the stars, you won't. And oftentimes you won't get there, but the journey is the destination.
Yeah, I'd strongly second that. I mean, I think any of these major projects, even something, that's very close to home here, the original Manhattan Project, bringing people together on something that may not be absolutely obvious that you can achieve, but has extreme importance and is very large. Things like, as someone mentioned, the Apollo program and things of that nature, I think are really crucial. Probably more crucial in this context are maybe things that are actually unachievable, that one aspires to. And I think that plays a critical role in human endeavor. And that can be, at the artistic level, can be at the scientific level, the cultural level, the political level, and so on. And I think this is something very essentially human, to articulate that and to make that into something to aim for.
And yet, we've created a society that is fundamentally risk-averse and extraordinarily judgmental and condemning of individuals willing to take those kinds of... Why have we built... If it's so self-evident to us, why have so many of the institutions that we've built, why do they operate in reverse?
I'd like to posit that maybe, a lot of the situations that you talk about came as a result of a challenge or a common enemy. All we have to do is look at, let's say, what happened at 9/11, and the entire United States Congress, except for Bernie, wound up getting behind, moving forward with invading Iraq. So, and the Apollo 13 mission was an effort to be able to show the Russians that we had the ability to land on the moon. So there was always this common issue that we had to overcome that galvanized a society or an effort to do something. Mm-hmm. And maybe we haven't had that recently.
I think there's another meaning to your question, mm-hmm. looking forward. Mm-hmm. All of the great, so-called great things that we've mentioned here in the last couple of minutes are really not so great in the sense that they were all completed within a fairly short space of time, 10 years, something like that. Mm-hmm. Maybe a value going forward of a really overarching goal would be to provide some continuity across generations. Because that's a problem that human beings have right now. Mm-hmm. We have a hard time feeling much obligation to our sons and daughters, our grandchildren. It doesn't really go beyond that. And this prevents us from undertaking great enterprises that are going to require the efforts and attention of many generations. So if we could think about larger goals that require that, that would provide a unifying force of the sort that we've never seen before.
I mean, it's happened. I mean, there have been, presumably, if you look at, under religions, if you look at the construction of pyramids or the great Gothic cathedrals. When we discussed this earlier in a conversation, that the, oddly enough, ideological, religious motivations are more powerful than economic and pragmatic ones. And so sort of an interesting paradox, perhaps.
Mm-hmm. Good.
That we, what do we do to replace the economic incentive? What do we build that would accomplish your objective?
Mm-hmm. You just need, really good communications to get people to work together for a long time on anything. And the advantage of a big moonshot is that it's easily articulated, everyone gets it, doesn't require a lot of explanation, and there's kind of a more or less clear path on how to get there. And with longer-term projects, it's even though they may have fundamentally a lot more merit than, say, a moonshot or building a dam or whatever, it's just harder to maintain the message across generations. I think religions are fairly good at that. So that's how we get cathedrals and other kind of long-term, you know, projects of that sort. But it really is first and foremost a problem of communicating with a lot of people and getting them to all align, feel aligned with a specific goal.
But David, are you saying that this is currently a problem, that we're not, as a whole, we're not thinking big enough? Because I'm always for critiquing us to think bigger. I'd like to challenge that a little bit, in that the things we have accomplished, we've mapped the human genome, similar efforts going on with the brain initiatives, the breakthrough initiatives, which are incredibly ambitious, interstellar project. I think our list of what we have accomplished, we're on the verge of imaging the first stars to ever flicker on in the universe with the James Webb telescope. I mean, that telescope. Anyway, my point is that the question implies we're going wrong on big picture ideas and motivation. And is that true?
Maybe not. I mean, the examples you give are very compelling, it seems to me. I think all of us have felt that sense of deep nausea when someone says to you that they're going to change the world and they show you a new restaurant finding app. And so there seems to be a disconnect between the sort of ambition, the rhetoric of ambition and the practice. So that's partly what I'm getting at. You know, I have this note, and it gets to Scott's point. It's sort of interesting, this point you raise about conflict and creativity, and Jeffrey mentioned the Manhattan Project, and we all live in the shadow of that and are in some sense beneficiaries of it, but also victims of it. And I just wanted to point out this list here, which is interesting, tennis game that really drove progress in the space race. So, you know, Sputnik, of course, which was really a sort of a wake-up call to the world that this was something possible to do. Americans abducted Wernher von Braun, and he then turned the V-2 missile into the first mechanism for launching North Americans, into orbit. The Russians put the first probe, I'm not giving you dates, 1959, the Russians put the first probe on the moon. 61, Yuri Gagarin goes into orbit. The US answers almost immediately with the Mercury program. John Glenn is in orbit in 1962. And then, of course, there's the whole Apollo program culminating in Apollo 11 and so forth. And so it's quite interesting that perhaps to your point, Dario, and some a remark that Scott made, the kinds of conflicts that we're experiencing now, very dispersed, very frightening, don't seem to lend themselves to this arms race that generates creative output. It's an odd moment. I'm curious to hear what people have to say about that. Somehow there was something about the Cold War that was terrifying, but it also generated incredible creativity. And how do we talk about that? Yeah.
I think maybe, and it takes off from some of the remarks in your introduction, was the big challenge we're facing now is to somehow galvanize and integrate those mysterious forces that allow people to think long-term, as they do maybe when building a Gothic cathedral, and so it's some spiritual association or connectivity. That, with the major driver of most things, and that is being threatened, seriously threatened. And the great problem in dealing with the huge challenges of global sustainability in the coming years, which is reaching an urgent, desperate stage, I would argue, is that we're not able to tap into those. They're not easily put into that. That is, people do not feel, even if you narrow your blinkers and think just of global warming, people don't see that as a threat, as Hitler marching into Poland, even though Hitler marching into Poland may prove to be tiny on the scale of what we're going to be facing in the next 20, 50, 100 years. Mm. So somehow we're not able to do that. Mm-hmm. We need something so much more visceral and immediate and physical.
So this question makes me think about the Breakthrough mm-hmm. project. So for those of you who don't know, Breakthrough Listen is a big project. You could probably explain it better. That is designed to listen to messages, find those messages from another civilization. And then Breakthrough Starshot, which is one that I'm more familiar with, is the idea of sending tiny spacecraft to Alpha Centauri and doing that within a human lifetime. Now, it's an ambitious project, and it's predicated on the idea that we have Earth-based lasers that can be directed at these spacecraft that have a sort of solar sail. And these lasers, you turn them on for 10 minutes and you send this chip on its way. And it's a fantastic idea. The physics actually works out. But to your point, Jeffrey, is that there are countries, Russia, Japan, and China, who are working on space solar power. Now, you have these floating solar photovoltaics, and you need to get it to Earth somehow. You can beam it to Earth, and this is a very powerful either microwave or laser beam, and this is the exact same technology that can be used to send these tiny spacecraft off to Alpha Centauri. So you have the big question of sustainability, those big questions, and here's a potentially very efficient way to collect energy. But you know, that looks a lot like a weapon, a powerful laser beam that can beam that much energy down to Earth. Likewise, a laser beam that sends these star chips off to another planetary system. So to me, it seems like there is something happening there, and I'm curious to see where it'll go in the next 10 or 15 years.
Right. To become an interstellar civilization, to the spirit of your event, David, seems to imply a type of global cooperation to not only build the technology, but that laser shoots over somebody else's airspace, for example. You know, there's a political dimension that would have to be sorted out, as well as the ethical people who would attach ethical drives to interplanetary and interstellar investigation and hopes, which I find fascinating too. Is there an ethical imperative to get us elsewhere, perhaps because we don't solve the unknown fate of our planet? And that goes to your earlier point about, well, why aren't we putting all the energy in solving the problems on the planet rather than putting that? But Art often gets this problem too, as far as, you know, well, Dario, if you care about XYZ, a social problem in the world, then why am I not at a soup kitchen all day? Why am I making art? As if it's some, you know, neutered response to this problem. And what I wanted to say to your earlier point was that, why do we even have to ask this question about our type of insecurity about the gestures we're making that are so big, and then we feel a type of pushback from a broader public about what's proper allocating of resources. But it always struck me as such a deep misunderstanding about the role of art and exploration as a basic factor of life, like shelter and food and et cetera. So at some point, culturally, we separated those gestures away from the fundamentals of just day-to-day living, rather than, but who wants to live by scraps day-to-day? You have to find a way to express that. And so my argument is that art is fundamental. It's always the case I try to make that we're framing the problem wrong when we say one thing is expendable as far as the ethical allocation of resources, because it should never have been taken off the table as a basic need of humanity.
It sounds like your effort is, and what the effort of this group is to raise an awareness within a society or a culture to get them stimulated, excited, and behind a project that's very, very important, which I think in our culture and our society today hasn't really happened in the same way that it happened, let's say, on some of the examples that you brought forth.
But it runs in parallel with despondency and idiocy, so particularly social and prejudicial political idiocy. And I guess part of what motivates me is to understand how we can use the mind and the heart, you know, science and art, to come together to explore some of these very long-term projects in that sort of somewhat naive spirit of the World Fair, of the Apollo program. I don't see that. I mean, maybe I'm wrong, and perhaps other people have a different opinion, and perhaps later when we have more of an open discussion, people will point out that that's wrong. But I don't see that as much as I would like to see.
I see us at a slightly different moment. So as a cosmologist, I'm struck by the fact that this is a very special moment in the history of our species. Really, I mean, like within the last 20 years, we're beginning now to get a glimpse of, if not the origin of the universe as a whole, but at least the history of our universe from the Big Bang to now. We're writing the chapters of the early origins of the human race from the cosmos to the planet. And with that knowledge now, we also get to look forward, because if you understand the past, you can predict the future. We're understanding how planets evolve, and we're understanding that our solar system is really remarkably wonderful, and we're lucky to have this planet. And furthermore, that it's very probable that we have 100 million more years, or maybe even a billion years, to thrive here. So we're the first generation in the history of our species for whom this gauntlet has been thrown down. What are we going to do with this opportunity, and should we even think in those terms?
But let me push you on that, because I'm wondering if your calculation is based on the expansion of our local star, because if the population growth continues at this rate, the calculation is that we need 3.5 billion acres of arable land to support a population of 10 billion vegetarians. My wife is a vegetarian. I'm not impugning the vegetarian, because that's how we're going to have to live in a world at that scale. So I can't see, it seems to me that some of the challenges are very imminent. I think this is partly what Jeffrey works has written about in his book Scale, that unless we fundamentally change our behavior in the next decade.
Absolutely.
Right, okay.
But why should we? You know, what is the motivation?
Yeah.
You might think that the prospect of a great future and that's a resource. So are we going to squander that? Or are we going to alter our present behavior it's really delayed gratification over millions of years. So I think that actually we're presented with a new kind of moral question today that our species has never faced before. That's why I'm here.
Yes.
Which is what? The moral question.
What do we owe to future generations? Mm-hmm. What do we deprive of future generations by leaving them a world that is less satisfactory, less nurturing, less productive than the one that we were lucky enough to inherit? Mm-hmm. It's very selfish.
Mm-hmm. Can I just add to that a little bit in less poetic terms?
But you do have that accent, so.
That, you know, I completely agree with everything that Sandy said, and in particular, we are, you know, certainly beginning with the Industrial Revolution, we've been on this extraordinary path, which has led us to the extraordinary kind of material life that we have, that many of us are privileged to have, the kind of standard quality of life that we've had. And built into that, though, are these terrible consequences, sort of unintended consequences that we're very familiar with. Everything from global warming and the scarcity of resources and so on and so forth. And as much as we innovate, the clock speeds up and life gets faster and so on. So, you know, we have to sort of come to terms with that. We need to understand that and come to terms with it. And a lot of that is driven by certain cultural behaviors, or maybe even universal behaviors. And that also we need to understand and in some ways address it. And I would even use the word make revolutionary changes in the way we act collectively as well as individually in dealing with these problems, so that, for example, rather than describing growth always in terms of physical economic terms, GDP, and so on, material wealth, that we start to try to think in terms of, it sounds a little more flaky, but in terms of contentment and happiness and so on. But we need to have a redefinition in the way we think about these things. And as I said earlier, to really behave in some different way so that we can sort of have our cake and eat it too, have wealth creation and innovation and new ideas and excitement without pushing us over the edge, which is where we seem to be headed.
Let me just point out, that's with a great sense of guilt. I referred to the telescope on a hill, the great, you know, that sits at the top of a pyramid of technological knowledge and GDP growth, which has effectively raped the planet. So the knowledge that we have that I referred to, cosmic knowledge, cosmic awareness, knowledge of the future, has come at great cost.
So let's talk a bit about this because you raised it, and I sort of want to ask Kate this question because of her experiences on her mission. And that has to do with the mutability of the human species. And I don't mean the biological mutability. I mean the social cultural mutability. So we know from ethnography and anthropology of the extraordinary variety of human institutions and forms of behavior. There are some universals, but nevertheless, there's a lot of variation. And I think one of the questions that the Interplanetary Project sort of asks is, by thinking about something very different, something very other to our own, it asks how different we can be from how we are now. And I think Jeffrey's point is, and Sandy's point is, we better be. So you lived in confinement, simulating for some brief period of time conditions on the surface of Mars. Mm-hmm. How did people behave, and how were they able to change and adapt?
Well, first of all, you said brief, and it was 4 months. So 4 months of living inside a dome with 5 other people, acting as if we were astronauts on Mars. We couldn't go outside unless we wore simulated spacesuits. As a kid dream come true. And we were there to provide a lot of data for NASA. NASA's really curious about the sociological and psychological factors that they need to consider in designing a mission to Mars, because If a human system breaks down on a 2.5-year mission to Mars, it could be as catastrophic as if a rocket explodes. So the data that we were providing, I'd like to think, was helping that mission be healthier and better for astronauts. And something that you mentioned in your question made me think about the fact that these questions that we're asking are extremely abstract. And so we are asking all of you and whoever is interested in interplanetary exploration to live at that abstract level, to just hang out there. And frankly, day to day, living on a Mars mission, we weren't doing that. We were thinking about toilet paper. We were thinking about toilets working well. We were thinking about who's doing the dishes. And we were thinking about why a certain person talks so much. So, you know, and it makes me also think about this idea that we're talking about how religion works really well for transmitting stories across generations. But something else that religion does that I think is really important to this discussion is it gets us at the large abstract level, and it gets us at the individual level, the heart. And I think that we need to touch both of those levels. We need to scale our ambitions here. So what can we do to appeal to the individual? And what can we do in an individual's day-to-day life, the quotidian? That you know, that's why people are comfortable, because their basic human needs are met. So they're not feeling the itch, this irritation to do something greater, potentially. There are certainly people who are, but there's a lot of complacency, and you know, we've been discussing that. It's because they, at a core level, their needs are either met or they're not met, and they're using their resources to meet those needs, and they actually can't get to or don't dwell in the abstract that we do. So I think one challenge that I would like to pose is that we think about ways to appeal to people's sense of the abstract and larger problem and hit them at their individual core. And so that's something that occurred to me on high seas, just seeing how, you know, mundane space exploration actually will be, even those first exploratory missions. I mean, how magnificent to leave the bounds of Earth's gravity and then be caught up in Mars gravity and then land and walk and hear the rocks crunch underneath your feet on Mars. It seems like such a wonderful thing. And right now we can all participate in that vision because no one's done it yet. But we're gonna have to get down to the nitty gritty and the details of that. And you know, I think we need to consider, when we are thinking about becoming interplanetary, what details matter and how we treat those details.
Yeah, it's interesting. One of the things that we were discussing, many of you have pets. I mean, you have animal, non-human animal companions. And we were discussing, you know, the history of animals in space. And the history of animals in space is a slightly sad story because they were our guinea pigs. The first animals in space, by the way, were fruit flies that were sent into low Earth orbit from White Sands in a missile. And the question was being asked is how they respond to radiation. And then we had a bunch of rhesus macaques. Of course, the Russians sent up various canines. And again, very sad stories. But one of the interesting features of space, I wonder who wants to comment on this one, is that one of the challenges for humans, and you didn't have this, Kate, in your experiment, is that humans don't do well in neutrally buoyant environments, in zero-G. And most astronauts, after a very short period of time, lose bone mass, lose muscle mass, lose vision. But on this planet, we have the majority of the surface of creatures that live with neutral buoyancy in the oceans. And I'm just curious, does anyone know of any efforts to send up fish or marine mammals that would be a better astronaut than a human?
I don't.
But they they still experience gravity.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes.
Sorry to be pedantic.
No, that's... Would you expand on that? And
Well, I don't think they'd fare any better. I mean, they wouldn't have any gradient that they could use to determine up and down.
It matters less, though, if you're a fish, right?
I don't know. I've never been a fish. I think it's pretty important.
But a fish needs a tank of water.
does.
With a certain, you know, and so you've got to have some sense of gravity to keep it, you know, contained. Yeah. In
how,
some
do you,
way.
How do you keep the water?
Oxygenated water.
Yeah, you're not really. I mean, buoyancy is a function of gravity. You're not really floating anymore if you're in a zero G.
You could send plants up. So it could send a tree. Maybe a tree is a better astronaut.
Have there been efforts?
Well, plants, of course, on mm-hmm. the space station. I love the question of, we were talking about earlier, I absolutely love the question of sending animals and plants. Animals, mostly because I think about our relationship to our pets here on Earth and how they offer a different mode of communication and affection. And so I think that from my experience of being 4 months isolated with 5 other people, you kind of crave a different way of being. And we had a great experiment going on. It was sort of proto-experiment to look at the possibility of robots as pets. And so basically the idea was just like offer an outlet that isn't human. So that I think, I would love to see something like that on a mission. It might be a difficult thing to finagle, but then plants too. Bring up the question of, you know, the systems that go to space. So you think about the technological system, that seems to have primacy. What does the ship look like? How is the rocket built? And then you have the human system, which always seems to be a little bit below the technological system, unfortunately. And then you have the ecological system. And there's some interesting things happening. Even on the space station, the bacteria that's growing is, it mutates faster, and it has a different profile in zero G, essentially, than it does on Earth. And so you have this sort of like shadow ecological system that's growing that no one really intended, and that interacts in some ways with the human system and the technological system. So you have all three systems kind of feeding off of each other in ways that we're just now starting to learn about. And I would love to see more exploration into how plant ecology, sending a tree up, with the relationship that we have with trees, and you know, like something that has a long time, lifetime, and being able to think in terms of like beyond the 2.5 year mission, that would be fantastic.
I think it would be beautiful to acknowledge we are not an isolated organism
right.
in our being, and to acknowledge that in these future missions, but and to add maybe a little slightly different ethical twist to the question about animals in space. If there is an ethical dimension to this whole endeavor, interplanetary, interstellar exploration, and you know, Hawking very famously says we've got to solve it in the next century, essentially, because of what he thinks our planet is doomed on an environmental level. But do we owe it to the animals that we are now killing to take them with us under that same premise of another shot for survival elsewhere? I don't mean this to sound like the Ark story, but it's not unlike that, I guess. Would that not be an ethical imperative? You know, even efforts on our own planet now, beautiful concept called restorative justice, all the way from if we can clone a creature that we have directly caused to go extinct, then do we have a moral obligation to bring them back? The seed bank, of course, in Norway, there's a zoo bank. So the spirit of humans doing that, feeling we owe it to the other life forms around us, but because of our behavior, how would we extend that out into space? Or should we? I guess is what I'm asking.
I think it's physically out of the question that people can spend a long period of time in zero G. Just for the reasons you mentioned, astronauts do it on the ISS for, you know, up to a year-ish. I can't remember what the current record is, but it's not good. It's not a good, you can't kind of go on living that way. So there has to be, we have to rotate things to produce simulated gravity, period. And so that implies building big structures that are either that or two little ones on the ends of a cable. But anyway, I don't think I suspect that building things that rotate is going to be easier than trying to create or find species of creatures that don't mind living in zero G.
So let me ask, so then this is the question raised by Jonah, which is that perhaps in the end, no organically evolved lineage is well suited to space. And we're going through a current sort of mini revolution in AI and machine learning. So his suggestion was precisely that one, that we don't go into space, that we somehow invest ourselves in digital technologies and hurl that out into space. I think it's something that you've talked about. And what about people's take on that, that perhaps the future of the humanity in the universe is a reflection of humanity in digital circuitry?
I just have a statistic. So it's an observation on the efficiency of biologically based thought. So I did a calculation a while ago based on Watson, IBM Watson. And Watson consumes a certain amount of power. And Watson is not quite at the level of a human brain. People extrapolating think maybe 20, 30 years we'll have computers that perform at the level of a brain. So take Watson's power consumption and scale it up to get the number of flops in a human brain. I forget the exact number, mm-hmm. but I think it was like megawatts of power mm-hmm. in order to make Watson perform at the level of a human mm-hmm. being, 25 watts. Mm-hmm. So this was sobering to me, the thought that somehow we could construct robots, which are basically electronic, to perform efficiently in interplanetary travel.
I mean, by the way, this week a new paper came out on a new answer to the Fermi paradox. The Fermi paradox is, if the universe is full of life, why haven't we heard from them yet? Right. And this answer was along your lines. It was that all evolving lineage eventually become digital, efficiently somehow. Mm-hmm. And but the most efficient state to be in is at very low temperature because of energy dissipation at high temperature. Mm. And so what the reason we haven't heard from them is because they're aestivating, which is like hibernating, waiting for the universe to expand sufficiently large that the effective mean temperature drops. And then they'll activate themselves and compute efficiently.
So 3 degrees is too hot.
Yeah, so that's but anyway. So.
Yeah, I take a, you know, I posit the concept that you know, species come and species go, right? And the planet doesn't. Mm-hmm. And that maybe we're moving towards the end of our species, or the end of our species as we know it. And that if we look at, you know, if we look at the science that we know of today, if we go back 40 or 50 years, people would look at us like we were crazy. You know, so what we don't know, that we don't know is ginormous amounts. And that, and it's not because you hate saxophonists, but there is the possibility, and I would even say the likeliness, that engineering and science would be able to develop something that allows us to generate that kind of power, and or that the computing brain of the future, the artificial intelligent brain of the future, does not need that kind of power. So to me, you know, I've seen it, having been involved with the Terminator movies, over a period of time, robotics and general artificial intelligence seem to be colliding. And, you know, we use movies and entertainment and whatnot oftentimes as the litmus test of what might be in the future, mm-hmm. you know, and there's the possibility that we no longer need these organic machines that we call bodies, and that one's brain and or a relationship that one has with an artificially intelligent being is the next iteration of what our species is. I don't see that as an impossibility.
The artist in me, when I hear these speculative playing out of these problems, is all the reasons that propelled us to these technologies, even thinking about interplanetary ideas, are, like Kate said, and you said too, a question of these other distinctly human behaviors. I'll say abstractly, as others did, about the heart. Projecting AI as our representative is this fundamentally a non-human thing. And so I'm torn between the idea that the heart, the goddess here, merged with the brain, would then now jettison some of those other aspects that may not be part of an efficient AI. That is what now goes out would seem to be getting off the problem too easy to me. I think it's a cop out. Not that natural and AI intelligence can't merge in some way, but I, as an artist, I would be a vocal critic about where is the line as far as what we're cutting out of ourselves to fulfill that task. I have a particular interest in the heart, for example, and let's say, you know, a robotic artificial heart suits long-term flight duration problems, much more efficient, and that may be the case. But I'd love to challenge: what are we giving up in the process?
You may not have a choice.
Well, but regardless, I want to be a poetic critic to the problem, because maybe that changes some behavior back down here in design stages. Maybe we decide that AI needs to have some of these other long non-negotiable factors on how we define ourselves. Because what are we sending out if the universe is filled with efficiently running AI, whatever that is, now takes the responsibility of communication. What impulse would that thing have to communicate the fundamental features of us that got us to that point?
You might be selling AI short.
Well, perhaps.
You might have a definition of what AI is based upon your concept of what a machine is, but in fact, it might not be a machine.
Right, but it will not be human. Would you agree on that?
I would think that it would not necessarily have the machine that we call the body, but it might very well have the mind and heart, maybe not organic, but a digital mind and heart that feels and acts and has sensibilities like humans.
It's interesting, though. I mean, one thing just on this issue, it comes back to the very opening question of what would you be most proud of? Uh-huh. And we all know on the original Golden Record, we have lots of non-human things. Mm-hmm. And you could say, well, maybe some compositions of Bach were created by a human, but that artifact that exists there doesn't have any of these features you're describing. And yes, sorry.
I'll give you an example. So early on when I was involved with running Lucasfilm, we had this small, interesting company that has now become this ginormous company called Pixar. And when we were discussing the possibility that computers could actually be a tool to be able to create art, right, all of Hollywood negated it. And they would say things like, well, how could a computer possibly do that? And the response, well, the computer doesn't do that. John Lasseter does that, who happens to drive the computer. And it wasn't until they saw Luxo Jr. That they actually got it. Mm-hmm. So it was so far outside of their optics, they couldn't see it at all.
They couldn't see that a machine was capable of making art?
That's correct. Well, the machine wasn't capable of making art. It was the person who was driving the machine that created the art.
Right. So in these future AI, where's that moment?
Well, I don't know. It's good. No, it's a good argument. But if someone else want to jump in on it, because it's very fruitful. Yeah.
Because I want to bring back to a much more conservative viewpoint. I think it's fantastic, and we should do everything we can to explore the other planets. I think it is who we are, and we should. We should explore, taking digital and AI to greater depths and heights. But, we understand so little at the moment about the brain, consciousness, love, hate, emotions, what life is really about. It's sort of loony, it seems to me, to think that in some, near future, we're going to have these cyborgs around. And even if we do, I agree with what is being implied here, they're not us. And frankly, I sort of don't care about them. what I care about is us. I care about who we are and what we are and how we can be part of the ongoing evolution of nature by preserving what we have, maybe leading to these new things in the same way that I don't actually care that much for those that preceded hominids. I mean, I care as a scientist about the biology, but I don't care viscerally again about it. But I care deeply and desperately about the future of socioeconomic human beings here and where we can go and be part of it. So I'm, you know, as much as I am very supportive of both the speculations and the hubris that's involved in a lot of this work, I think it goes to the opening of this little session when you said that Jonah said, let's focus on us, so to speak. Let's really spend our energy on trying to understand us and getting us through what I see of as a truly a defining moment in the history of human beings. And by the way, human beings will survive. I don't think that's an issue. It's the question of, will human beings that live socioeconomically like us survive? So, you know, we may end up being hunter-gatherers, and maybe that's okay. But so it's very much refocusing on us, but seeing it in the context of interplanetary. And we had a discussion earlier, which I resonate with very strongly, that vision is, when you think interplanetary, is to expand the scale so that we can look back at us and see us in a much bigger context, which I think is also crucial as part of our ongoing evolution.
Well, I think maybe we've gone in the wrong direction by comparing and contrasting digital life with biological intelligence. Because the way I see it, if we're successful in getting through the nexus of the next 100 years or so and solving the environmental issues, then our technology as we know it now will be long-lived. And Jeffrey, we're probably about to embark on the most rapid evolutionary rate of human beings that we have ever seen. And I'm talking about genetic engineering. Mm-hmm. And it will start, as it already is, seemingly targeted at specific issues which seem easy to solve. But frankly, where is human nature in our genome? You know? So there's this famous this famous statistic about rodents, I think. The mountain vole and the prairie vole. Mm-hmm. And the mountain vole, I may have it backwards, their genomes are practically identical, but the mountain vole is monogamous and mates for life, and the prairie vole is, you know, has short-term relationships.
Is it right. Polygamous or serially
polygamous? It's polygamous.
Yeah. It's polygamous.
Polygamous.
So, this has been identified as being due to a stretch of 300 base pairs. And nobody even knows what that base pair does. It doesn't even make a protein. It's just there. So I throw that out as an example of the secrets that are hidden and the dangers that are hidden in our genome. So I don't know that we know that the human beings that you know and love, if we solve our environment problem, we're not...
No, but that's why I said part of the evolutionary process. I don't think, you know, nothing stays the same.
Well, I'm just pointing out it's not an evolutionary process like anything we've ever seen.
Well, I would slightly disagree with that. The fact that we are participating in it, that we are it. So it is. It still is evolutionary.
It's just different.
Well, it may be different than it was, but it still works at a genetic level, and it's, you know, it needs to be fixed in the population, et cetera, et cetera. And, you know, there's plenty of people out here that are monogamous and polygamous and, you know, do all kinds of other weirdo things. So, you know, and...
It is interesting, though, and it's something that I know that Neil has written about in his books, which is this: where will we be most mutable?
Yes.
Right? Is the variability possible socially, psychologically, culturally, mm-hmm. which is how we've tended to think, or are we tethered in some foundational way, physiologically, cognitively, to our genome, in which case CRISPR-Cas9 and all of that universe of new, you know, gene manipulation technology is going to be our future. So, Neil, you've written about this, and you did opt for the genetic
solution. Well, you're talking about 7 Eves.
Yes.
Well, in that case, it's a forced situation, so it's not people voluntarily evolving, but they're placed in a situation where they have to do something. And it starts with fixing problems. So if you've got a known medical condition that's caused by a documented genetic issue that can be fixed, then, well, obviously, that needs to be fixed. It'd be silly not to cure that problem. but then it rapidly gets into kind of thornier issues around. By the way, I can talk about this at length, but it doesn't seem like we're talking about planets and space.
Well, but it's in a way, I think we are.
I don't think we are.
But I wanted to.
I think we're talking about everything but that. But
well, okay, so let's okay. We'll go there in a second. I think it's important. I was explaining earlier in a conversation we were having, what is this interplanetary project? And I think it's several things. And I think one thing it is a lens. It's a lens through which to bring issues which are often out of focus into focus by presenting the problem very starkly. And so we don't have to be talking about space travel for the concept of the interplanetary question to be valuable. And I think, and it gets to my opening remark about the irresponsibility, which you have alluded to, the culmination of a telescope sitting on the rubble of life and pain and so forth. So I'm not sure. So, but let's, to satisfy you, Neil, let's go there a little bit in relation to real prospects in the coming years. I mentioned conflict, and the conflict that I mentioned before was the conflict between superpowers. But the conflict that we now observe is the conflict between super billionaires. And the modern space race is people like Musk and Bezos and Branson, Blue Origin, SpaceX, and so on, Vulcan, Paul Allen. So what's really going on here? What is behind the current enthusiasm? Is this economic and not being stated? It's not really aspirational. And what's really likely to happen in the next 5 to 10 years? Is Musk really interested in Mars, or is he interested in mining asteroids? What's behind the current enthusiasm for space?
Testosterone?
So the audience have answered the question very convincingly. Anything else? Anything slightly more optimistic?
I think it's partly that, well, it's absolutely testosterone, but in addition to that, there's a huge bank of information that's just sitting there. So all of the things that the Cold War space program learned about how to do space, that's available now. So if you tried from scratch to learn all that stuff, it wouldn't work. It would be too expensive, I think. But a lot was learned, and so there's a huge reservoir of wisdom and knowledge and data about how to do it that these people can tap into. And then there's just sort of the strange phenomenon of certain people making a lot of money and having the resources to apply against these kinds of projects. And finally, there's kind of, I don't know if these are related or they just happened at the same time by accident, but there's the kind of boiling frustration with the perceived failure of the space program to follow through on the stuff that we were all promised as kids.
Given the people that you mentioned, I have to assume it's greed and money. It just has to be. What other driving force? I mean, I'm sure Jeff Bezos is a lovely guy and, you know, and the rest, but he's driven by his capitalist needs. And so I have to assume it's he sees a reason and Elon Musk sees the reason for an opportunity to capture a marketplace and make a whole lot of money.
I think we also can't ignore Moore's law, the shrinking of microprocessors, and the fact that you can now send a satellite into space that's, you know, about the size of a grapefruit, and it can do something useful and interesting, and that is collect data, and that there is a market for data, that data in particular. So I think it's a confluence of a couple of things. This rocket technology that's been sitting around that smart people thought, hey, I think I can improve upon this, and the fact that a market has opened up for the data that can be garnered by these satellites that are watching us.
I mean, there is also the cosmic pessimism. I mean, we were talking about the sustainability of life on Earth, and I think I've heard from several of those individuals, in addition to the lucrative economic possibilities, this notion that Stephen Hawking often vociferously articulates, that it's that or extinction. So I don't know if Darian...
Well, if we remove from the economic side of some of those endeavors and broaden out to other exciting fields that fall under interplanetary, like the search for life, which Kate can also speak to that through the breakthrough lens, but I often come back from these meetings just blown away at the palpable sense of excitement and enthusiasm on the field of finding microbial life, at the minimum. Intelligent life is another can of worms. But I often leave thinking, I didn't mean it that way.
It really is, isn't it?
But I often leave thinking why, in our discussions about good storytelling, the enthusiasm in that room, how is it not more broadly what's truly a revolution occurring in this field? In astrobiology, the search strategies are changing, new, fresh ideas are coming to the table in the past 10, 15 years that just have never been there. And it's palpable, and I always feel this compelling need as an artist to help tell that story. So, for example, 3 years ago, the chief scientist of NASA, many of you may have picked up on that news story, but, you know, at a congressional panel, she said she thinks we will have an answer in the next 20 to 30 years. And I don't know why that didn't make all of us just sort of stop what we were doing in a field of science that is notoriously hesitant to give any timeline to the detection of life elsewhere, to start putting numbers to the hope for discovery. We are in an exciting moment on this field that I don't think has anything to do with the economics. It's that basic, are we alone question that will always drive us. Either way, either answer, it's profound. Either we're alone, it's profound, or we're not, it's profound. You can't go wrong. So. But my point is that to answer you what's part of the enthusiasm, I'm keeping my eye on all the other examples you gave, but to me, the more interesting stuff is over here on these other topics that are still driven by big governmental agencies like NASA. The Kepler telescope has absolutely changed our view of the cosmos. And so I want to give some voice the things outside economics that are still driving us and that we should all be excited that at least the experts think we're on the cusp of something incredible.
I do want to say it just for the audience if they're not clear why, because you can't really prognosticate about the time that you could predict the existence of life. And part of the optimism comes from the very recent discovery of a very large number of exoplanets, so planets circulating stars that live in what are called Goldilocks zones, that is zones around a star that might be capable of supporting water. And so this is partly why they're... Now, I want to open up to the audience, but I want to ask one final question of the panel, and it's the question from the 1951 film When Worlds Collide. And that is, who gets to go? And it should not be the CEO of a Silicon Valley tech company. And the way they solved the problem was with a lottery. But it still led to murder and revolution. Just curious. Let's say that we don't have a lottery. And we do get to choose. Who or what profession, yourselves not included, would you choose to send on a truly interplanetary mission?
How many people?
Well, I don't know, you pick, you know, not a reasonable amount. It can't be, you know, the...
7 billion.
So the spaceship Earth answer, yeah.
We're on a spaceship.
Yeah, that's a good point. Neil?
How would you, what, you're asking who would I pick or what mechanism would I propose?
Both, you can answer either way, that's interesting.
Oh, man. I mean, I...
Where do you come up with these things?
They're on my phone.
I think it would...
What's the point, actually, of this question?
Seriously. Should I explain? The point of the question, I think...
I mean, I love that film. That's a fantastic film.
Yes.
But...
Why? What's the philosophical root?
What's the... Yeah, what are we trying to get at here? That's what I'm asking. What are we really asking?
I think we're asking... It's a little bit coming full circle to what would we be most proud of. And so what are we trying to preserve and what best represents the best of what we have done or who? And that's the kind of philosophical premise.
I know who I wouldn't send.
Well, it depends on the reliability of the spaceship.
Right.
I can't get away from the political, the sort of tactical calculations that would have to go into it. You know, you would have to... You already alluded to the kind of rioting and wars and so on in, that ensue when people start squabbling over things like this. And so it's going to end up, realistically, it's going to be end up being some sort of compromise scheme that leads to the least amount of warfare and murder. It's not really my specialty. I don't know what the, trying to satisfy people in a political kind of conversation is a hard problem, right? But that's what it would have to come down to.
I didn't hear what you said, Jeff.
The whole planet.
7.5 billion.
What? Oh, the 7.
7 billion. No,
I think it's obvious we'd send pygmies and dwarfs.
It's not obvious.
You'd fit more on the spaceship.
A strong argument for sending
Well, that actually plays into a piece I wrote for Slate that proposed sending an all-female crew to Mars because metabolically, women on average require about half the calories as men, you know, just on average.
No, not half.
And when you have...
In Alabama.
For 2.5 years, the food stores that you're bringing with you, if you can have that weight, that's a significant economic advantage. So if you like thinking about space exploration in terms of money, you might consider sending an all-female crew.
Female pygmies and dwarfs.
Exactly.
But to reference another movie, one of my favorite lines, many of you probably know in Contact, is when Jodie Foster says, we should have sent a poet. I don't say this because I'm highly biased, but of course we should send an artist. I wonder on the political dimension of Neil's point, if that would get us closer to some sort of consensus, that does it truly strike us as a wrong decision to send an artist on the crew? My impulse, I'm biased, like I said, but I don't know. I don't think the impulse would be, oh my God, absolutely not. You know, it would maybe get somewhere to a consensus. But yeah, we've got to send artists. We've got, at minimum, they've got to be embedded with the crew.
Yeah,
and you have an incredible story on that you should
just a nature writer, someone who can see landscape and then convey that back here on Earth. I mean, it would just be magnificent. So I feel like nature writers, artists who can interpret what they see, reality in front of them, and find some sort of truth within it, and then give that back, would be fantastic.
Yeah. Go on.
I guess it would depend upon what the mission was. Why are we sending people? Are we sending people to tell extraterrestrials who we are? Are we sending people to start a new society? What's the purpose of this group of people that we're sending?
You choose.
I'd send the Dalai Lama.
All right. On that note, we should thank the panel. So I think we're going to open it up to, there are two microphones that will be roaming, and we're going to open it up to questions of any variety. So let me see it. So I should have my glasses on, so if anyone sees better than I do. There's one question over
right in the middle.
Right there, and we'll come over to the side. Right here first. Over here, Tim. Left, back. There you go. That chap. Oh, well, whatever.
Thank you. With so many problems that we have on the planet, why are we thinking of going someplace else? Can we not use our, by the way, knowledge is not wisdom. So could we use the knowledge that will lead us into wisdom and concentrate on this beautiful, sacred planet? I mean, it looks like a lot of mind gymnastics, but it leaves me cold.
I think that's what we discussed that issue at length.
I love this question.
Yeah, I advocated that, yeah. Basically.
This
but
is
you weren't listening.
I do love this question because so many people have said it better than me, but when you leave home, the first time you leave home is, and then come back, is the first time you actually see home and where you came from. And it would be, that would be a gift to this planet.
Who's talking? No.
So, given most of the discussion has been about...
Where are you?
Over here.
Okay, yes.
Most of the discussion has been about the challenges of getting there or staying here. So at what point does what we have to do to get out into the stars or live here become too much? Is there ever a point where the cost of going out is too great, just either economically or ethically, for us to make the journey?
I do want to, it's a good question, I do want to point something out, and I'm sure other people have something to say on this, is that the economics are not fixed. It's extraordinary that the cost of building, say, a probe is very nation dependent. So, recently China has become very involved and India very involved. And for the same mission, India were able to build probes that were almost an order of magnitude less, not quite that much, less than the United States. And I know that Kate has thought about this quite a bit, the regulatory dimension of that. It might be worth mentioning that.
Right. Costs are not fixed, and it's kind of a construct of the structure with that you are building your spaceship or your missions within. So if you can kind of look around, NASA is not the only game in town. Obviously, SpaceX decided to rethink the economics of rockets by making rockets reusable, not based on the premise that would be cheaper. We'll see how much cheaper that will be. But these things aren't fixed, and I think that there's a lot of fun fiddling with numbers that people are doing. I don't know if fun is, I don't know why I said fun. But, so in India, I know that one reason that they can send a probe to Mars nearly an order of magnitude cheaper than NASA is, it's not as complex, the probe that they're sending. They're using a cheaper rocket, but they can also bypass a certain amount of bureaucracy. bureaucracy serves a purpose, but in this case, they're really able to kind of like bypass that. So I think it's interesting to think about all the systems that go into play when you're traveling outside of Earth.
And one of the reasons why Obama, closed a number of federal programs and established a fund where NASA funded private activities, most notably Boeing and SpaceX, was because they would minimize the costs by eliminating bureaucracy. So this is a field that's, by virtue of being federal, has in some respects been very ambitious, but also very inefficient.
I'm going to ask, why do humans explore? Because even well before there was modern transportation, people were in just about every inhabitable part of the Earth, and is going to another planet just part of being human and exploring?
I think it's to get away from other humans. No, I mean, I actually think that, like, if you see the way that, like, there's different theories on how North America was reached from Asia, but one of the more convincing theories is that it happened very, very quickly down the coast. That in a short period of time, comparatively speaking. They got from the Bering Straits to Tierra del Fuego because it's easy to go down the coast, and there's food there. The conditions are pretty moderate. My suspicion is that once they found an unlimited coastline in front of them, it was just basically a race to get away from their neighbors. So I'm not saying everybody feels that way or behaves that way, but I think enough people feel that way that they can travel a long ways in a short period of time.
I think that's Stephen there. Yes.
I've been listening to this conversation about the making of art and the telling of stories and the value of long-term vision and multi-generational thinking, cosmology, and communities, sustaining communities. And my thought is that there's something missing, and for me that would be the perspective of indigenous communities around the world, which I think could very much enrich this conversation. Thank you.
We actually had a long conversation about that today in a previous meeting. So I think there's great sympathy here for your remarks and an intention to act on.
Yeah, and moreover, in the state that we're in with, as we've discussed in the past, sort of extraordinary archaeoastronomy, sort of beautiful edifices that allowed us to explore the universe. And so absolutely, I mean, part of the, I should just say, just passing before the next question is, one of the objectives of this interplanetary project, this festival, is to be radically inclusive. I mean, most of these things, you have to pay a huge sum of money, and now we are remote, so you'd have to get here. But one of our ambitions is to sort of mirror, if you like, the philosophy of the open source movement, and that's come up a lot in our conversations, to make the ideas and aspirations of this globally available and not be restrictive. So it's an important point.
One other thing about that, I find that, so I haven't always been involved in the space community. I suppose I am now, but something that I've noticed about a lot of the people who are passionate about it is that they feel like they are outsiders, and this drives a lot of the impulse to go someplace else. And I wonder if, for me personally, that was part of my interest in space in the beginning, because maybe I saw myself outside of something, some culture that maybe I didn't feel a part of. So I think that a huge range of voices should be a part of this conversation. The idea of diversity for diversity's sake doesn't really work here, because the only way to answer these questions is to include, it wouldn't even be to include, is just to have it be a conversation between people who have had a range of experiences with the dominant culture and then outside of that culture. So space, you know, I've heard the tagline, space is for everybody. It's really not right now. I would love to see a conversation that, a conversation in the mainstream that is more about everybody. Thanks for that question.
Hello. It's been a fascinating discussion. It seems to me that most of our discussion seems to have focused on shipping our gene pool physical bodies out into space. And I'm not quite sure what the purpose of that is. To me, it seems that two most critical things facing us is how can we better utilize the planet that we have, particularly the under-ocean planet, which has still pretty much remained undiscovered and is available for 7 billion people to somehow survive. And I'd rather hear some more talk about the real likelihood is how do we project a communication outreach and be able to receive an intelligent response across the vastness of space. I'm not so wild about just shipping somebody to Mars and back. I mean, it would be very good geological information and how the planets may be evolved. But the real idea of communicating with other galactic species seems to be more one of a challenge of how do you communicate, what would you say, what would you want them to tell you, and then also, how much of our resources are we spending doing that versus trying to figure out how to make this planet more survivable for a few more hundred years at least?
I do want to address this issue. It keeps coming up. And I, so that the first question is very interesting. I do want to get to the second bit, though, which is it's a false dichotomy. And I think that, again, the interplanetary perspective suggests that there are ways of solving exactly the kinds of problems you're describing locally by asking extraordinarily ambitious questions that extend beyond the boundaries of the planet. And I think I just want to make that very clear that that's a very important part of this. It's not an attempt, as per your question over here, to absolve ourselves of earthly responsibilities. In terms of the other question, there's been a huge amount of work, and I don't, Breakthrough, I know, worry about this a lot. I don't think they really know the theory, quite frankly, and we've discussed this. But is anyone wanting to discuss this approach?
Well, it is. It also has become privatized with the Breakthrough initiatives in an interesting way, to your question. Besides building rockets or getting to low Earth orbit or Mars or the moon, there is this push with Yuri Milner to help privatize that effort, which is called Breakthrough Listen, and that'd be a place to catch up on the developments in the field. It's a $100 million investment over 10 years, so he's putting a significant amount of his own resources into that. And I just would love to second David that it's not an either-or proposition. Because if you keep going down that road of what about our planet, then, which we should, but this is never at the cost or expense of how we're thinking about our interactions on the planet. The argument is that we're going to solve our problems here by trying to get elsewhere. There, that is a direct benefit of the endeavor. Plus, at the end of the day, I find it a less interesting question because nobody can stop human exploratory zeal. And so it's a condition of our humanity, and I'd rather put my energy into asking how to make that successful, knowing that it's going to help us solve the problems here. I'm curious why that dichotomy comes up so much.
Yeah, I don't know.
Well, your tagline again, what was it?
It was the tagline is changing the world one planet at a time, right? And so that is the spirit of it. And so
there's one last question over here.
There's one there. Yeah, sure, and there's one back there as well. So, yes.
Oh. Well, I was going to kind of bring this literally down to Earth. Responding to what you said was a primary motivator for space travel, and that's usually the result of the need to solve immediate problems and resolve conflicts and attain goals. Now, the elephant in the room that I thought might be a motivator for penetrating deep space would be the threat of an extinction event through an asteroid impact, and that all of our resources are now being put into deeper and deeper penetration of space, in part to locate any kind of such threat. How much of that do you think it constitutes sort of a shadow motivator for much of the contemporary development in space travel that we're seeing today?
Mm-hmm. It's hard to divert them, and you don't want to get it wrong. A thing that is true of both that and of efforts to use engineering against global warming, global climate change, is that if you know how to do it for good, you can also do it for bad. So if you've got the ability to divert an asteroid that looks like it might hit the Earth, you've also got the ability to drop one on a country that you don't like. So that makes it a little bit ticklish to go developing that kind of technology. I'll just make the point that you can get into similar conversations about just about any technology that's been proposed to solve the global climate change problem through geoengineering. That, okay, once we have the ability to do that, who decides where it's going to be used and how much we're going to use it?
Well, I would argue, maybe, that metaphorically, an asteroid is on its way to hit the Earth. That is, the whole question of global sustainability is, in fact, that if we continue pretty much the way we're continuing, we're on the way to some major catastrophe that could be deeply threatening to all of us on this planet in terms of the kind of existence that we've created. And the issue, going back to what we said earlier, is that we can't get that across to people, that it is like that, that it's, in fact, analogous to some very physical threat for the planet, rather than that somehow, you know, it's all going to turn out all right and nothing to worry about. Eventually, we'll figure it all out and we'll innovate ourselves out of the problem, and so on and so forth. AI will do it. Nanotech 20 years ago was going to do it. Big data will do it. All they will do is postpone the problem. That asteroid is on its way, and we better start changing the way we behave, our culture, we interact with each other, and start to address this problem seriously. And we should have, you know, sort of $100 billion or maybe $1 trillion international project that is addressing this issue, to really understand it and address it, instead of what I perceive as twiddling our thumbs. So it is happening. That's the interplanetary part.
So on that note, pessimistic and optimistic, thank you very much.